This is David Deutsch. I'm here with Todd Brown, and we are going to be talking about swipe files, one of the most underutilized, misunderstood, potentially powerful tools at the disposal of a copywriter. And from what I understand, your secret weapon that you've had over the years in terms of helping you write copy, Todd.
Yeah, I think I would say that I know the other day, right at yesterday, maybe, or the other day, you put out a video and you talked about what to read, which I loved, right? What to read.
Oh, yeah.
To learn your copy. And I loved it. Like, I was taking notes and seeing what I had in the library and what I didn't have. For me, one of the secret weapons, I really believe, to call it a secret weapon, I really believe that just relentlessly reading good copy day after day really helped me to become in tune with the flow and feel of good copy. Like I always say, it took me many years to realize there's a difference between copy and good copy. I always say, I tell our clients and students that good copy doesn't feel like copy. It doesn't read like copy. It doesn't sound like copy. It doesn't have that hyperbolic bent to it. It's not puffery. You oftentimes with good copy, you don't even realize that you're being led to a destination. You almost feel like you're being informed and educated and you're discovering new things along the way. And so when I started to collect and aggregate good copy and read on a regular basis, it wasn't always every day, but that's when I really feel like I started to it started to become like one with me. Like I was immediately after I read, and I believe that this is true for everybody. And I'm talking, so David, passive reading, even before I understood the value of looking at like, why are they saying this here? And what emotional trigger are they trying to, are they trying to stimulate exclusivity here? Are they trying to create urgency here? Are they trying to overcome an objection here? Even before I was able to recognize any of, and I was reading good copy. When I then went back to, or when I was then exposed to what today I would call subpar copy, I was easily able to spot the difference right away, just from the feel, the tone, the phraseology, the flow. And yeah, it played a big, for me, I think that reading good copy and reading good copy often is a powerful thing for even the average schmo like me.
Yeah, it's a great point. We talk about a swipe file as if we're supposed to swipe from it. And indeed, there are ways of doing that intelligently where it's not stealing, but you're inspired by the underlying ideas. But even beyond its purpose for that, just having it and reading it infuses in you, you know, what makes good copy. And like you say, also what makes for not good copy.
Yeah. Yeah. I love that. I love that a lot because I think it's so important that, you know, that for copywriters, for direct response marketers, that what you're exposing yourself to on a regular basis, that it's good, it's effective, it's productive, because you can very easily start to even unconsciously replicate what it is that you're being exposed to, thinking that it's good copy, that it's good, effective persuasion, argumentation, when it's really not. And so it really is important that you're exposing yourself on a regular basis to good, solid, call it tested and proven copy. The other thing that you said, which I love, you use the word inspiration, right? I think, David, tell me what you think about this, that I think I'm almost reluctant to even use the word swipe. Mm-hmm. I know that swipe file is the accepted term and I use it because it's what everybody knows, but there seems to be there's like this negative connotation associated with swipe. And I think rightly, because I think a lot of new marketers, they misuse a swipe file and they steal. They take large chunks of copy and paste it into their own campaign or funnel or sales letter or whatever. And that's not what we're talking about, right? We're talking about something that gives inspiration, insight, something that exposes you to the proper flow, the proper order, as well as certainly some phrases, the better ways to introduce an offer, better ways to justify price, better ways to present a guarantee. but it's meant for modeling, for inspiration. It's why I like to almost refer to it more as a muse file. It's a muse file. It's a file to give you insight and inspiration to better improve your own copy, your own campaigns. And so what do you think about that?
I wanted to say a couple of things. One is when you said about having good pieces of copy around you, it reminded me of, you know, how you're the product of the five people you hang around with, yeah. average of their income. In a way, your copy is the average of the copy that you hang around. And that
I'm going to steal that. I like that. I'm going to steal that. I'm going to swipe that. Okay. I like that a lot. Right. That's a great way to frame it. And I like that.
I think you make a really interesting distinction between swiping, right? And that's not what we want to do. That's not even what it's productive to do. But John Carlton gives that great example of somebody taking his one-legged golfer ad and making an ad about a one-legged accountant. Right. And it's like, oh, for God's sake, did you not understand the whole basis of why a one-legged golfer is so good, right? So what you want to do, and it's a great example of how not to swipe, you want to look at that and say, what made that one-legged golfer so powerful? A golfer who's only got one leg, obviously, how could he be good at golf? How could he balance? How could he do things? So I'm intrigued, and any system that works for him is going to work for me because I've got two legs and I can balance, right?
Yeah.
And so when you're thinking about it for accountant, maybe you want to think about an accountant that flunked math in high school, is able to take this course and do his own bookkeeping and save tons of dollars or something.
Yeah, no, I think that's you're so right. And that's so brilliant in so many ways. And I think that what you said, the whole swiping the one-legged golfer, I think that we unfortunately see that often with a lot of things, right? Like the XYZ, what they don't want you to know. And like, it's misapplied, right? In another industry or another marketplace where that makes no sense, like whatsoever. And so I think you're right. And I love what you said about, look, there's the value in having good copy and reading it passively just to become like more in tune, as I said, with the flow and pace and the order and whatnot. But then there's also the value of reading good copy and regularly asking yourself, why are they saying this here? Why are they saying this? What is it that they're ultimately trying to do? What is the purpose, the aim of this chunk of copy? What emotion are they trying to elicit? What thought or belief are they trying to install? And I really first learned this. I got to give credit where credit is due. This way of reading with kind of a different lens on from our mutual friend, Joe Schrieffer. I remember when I was in Baltimore one day at the Agora Financial offices. And at the time, Joe Schrieffer was the copy chief, and Agora Financial at the time was they were on top of the Agora company's mountain. And we were talking about how they're able to train new copywriters, how they were able to take virtually, I like to say, people off the street and turn them into productive copywriters fairly quickly. And when I asked Joe, what was at the heart of their system, their process for doing that? One of the things that he said to me, and then he showed me, was he had them read a good piece of copy every day, and he had them annotate the chunks based on what the copywriter was trying to do, the objective, the emotional trigger, the persuasion device, like what was the reason why the copy existed? And which also, David, brings us back to the value of good copy. See, I believe that, and you jump in and you tell me, you're the pro, you're the A player in this conversation, that when you're reading good copy written by a great marketer, great copywriter, that there's no throwaway paragraphs or sentences. Everything is said with intention. There's a reason why every bit of copy is included. There's an objective. There is something that copy is there to achieve. This is wildly different from average, typical online marketing copy, where there's often just extraneous thoughts and a copy that doesn't even really need to be there. Right. It's not really serving a purpose. It's more filler than anything. When you're reading a good piece of copy and you know that everything is there with a purpose and an objective, reading it also under the microscope of what is this trying to achieve, right? What is the purpose of this? Over time, you start to see with a good swipe file, you start to see these trends of what they're achieving, when they're achieving it, where in the sales letter or the marketing argument they're achieving it. And that's just enormously valuable to, right, to really get that much better at copy. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I think you see patterns. Okay, when this, it's a pattern, right? Yeah. And really, it's a matter of reproducing those patterns, not copying the words, right? But copying the pattern. And there are so many, there's the micro pattern of, okay, what's going on in the beginning? What's going on in the middle? What's going on in the end? How does this look in a macro sense? Then there are more and more micro patterns, right? How does a section work? How do the sections relate to each other? What happens internally in a section? What happens in a paragraph? What happens in a sentence? How does he choose words? Oh, look at that. He uses small words compared to me. I use these great big fancy words. He uses little bitty words. I use vague verbs. He uses really pinpoint specific verbs. I can learn from that.
Yeah.
And I think part of what people like Joe do is what I like to call like a forensic analysis, the CSI. Joe comes in, he's dusting for fingerprints. He's shining black light so he can see where's the blood stains. He's tracing the history back. Yeah. He's interviewing. It's a full forensic deep dive into what he's looking at. It's not just a superficial reading of it.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that's such a good point. That's interesting.
Richard Feynman once said something really interesting. He said about physics, he said, know how to solve all the problems in physics that have already been solved. And the same thing is true with copywriting. Know how to solve the problems that have already been solved.
Yeah.
Porter Stansberry and Mike Palmer solved the problem of how to talk about debt at a time when it was good economic times. They solved the problem of how to talk about that and make it into a powerful piece with End of America.
Yeah.
So figure out how they solved that problem. How did this person solve the problem of weight loss, right? How did they solve that problem of making it in a new, like, South Beach diet or why French women don't get fat? Solve the problem of people are tired of hearing about how to lose weight. They don't believe anything anymore. How do you wake them up from that stupor? They solve that problem.
Yeah. And yeah, that's also a great point. And I think, why do you think, David, that there is this, for whatever reason, this desire by a lot of copywriters or direct response marketers to either try to start from a blank page or feel the need to start from a blank page? Why do you think more don't really understand the enormous value of a swipe file? Where do you think that comes from?
Yeah, I think probably some of it is not knowing how to use. They think they either just steal from it and just take the words. They don't know how to look at it and let it trigger ideas.
Yeah.
Like we were talking about with the one-legged golfer.
Yeah.
They say, I can't use a one-legged golfer. You know, what else we got?
Yeah.
Instead of thinking, what can I do? What's the essence of, they laughed when I sat down at the piano, but when I started to play, that's not going to work for me. But if you think about what is it with your product that people want to look good in front of others because of, that they want to get redemption of, that they've always been told they can't do. And you're going to make it that they can do. How can you portray that in an honest way and with integrity and without swiping and in an honest way and be inspired? Like you said, be inspired by that. Have that be your muse.
Yeah.
You can use so many things, right, to trigger something. You could think of banana, right? And you could use it to come up with a headline.
Yeah.
Somehow, just because of associations, maybe it's yellow, maybe it's peel, maybe that makes me think of appeal. This has got a certain appeal. Whatever it is, get your brain's need stimulation.
Yeah.
And knowing how to use a swipe file is getting the stimulation that your brain needs from the masters.
Yeah. Yeah. So many great points that you made. First, I think to just piggyback on what you said, you know, is right. Once you really it goes without saying that as a copywriter, as a direct response marketer, you really have to begin first by really understanding your marketplace and understanding the psychology of the people that you're talking to, understanding what it is, their wants, their desires, their emotions, their feelings, their beliefs. Like, you have to really understand who you're talking to, what makes them tick, what they want, what they don't want, what, how they view their problem, how they view the ideal solution, what their current state is, what the ideal outcome is. Obviously, I believe that every marketer, schooled and serious marketer and copywriter, really recognizes that. Once you know that, right, and you have that as the foundation, I think then you can start to get more clarity on what are the emotional triggers that are most appropriate for that market. The idea of, let's say, exclusivity, or the idea of, let's say, really stimulating fear, maybe those aren't always appropriate in every market for every promotion, right? It all depends on the audience, right? Everything that we talked about. But once you're clear on who the audience is, you can begin to get clarity on what are the emotional triggers and appeals that are going to be appropriate for them. That's where the value of a swipe file could come in, because then you can see how others have used the underlying appeal of the one-legged golfer, the idea that if he can do it with a deficit, then you can do it without a deficit. How else has that kind of appeal been applied by other smart marketers with great copies? Exclusivity, right? There's more than one way, of course, to leverage exclusivity. There's more than one way to stimulate the feeling of urgency. There's more than one way to demonstrate scarcity. There's more than one way to stimulate the feeling of belonging. There's more than one way to trigger the positioning of authority, credibility, all of those things. And so I think that once you've got the understanding of your marketplace, you've got some clarity on what are the emotions that are going to drive this person most based on what they care about, then you can use a good swipe file to get ideas for different ways that you can go about, that you can go about doing that. And the other thing, go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, and that enables you to use swipe that's not even in your market.
Yeah.
Because you can see how someone in a totally different market used exclusivity, which is what you want to use. And you could learn from that. And just wanted to interject really quickly that what you said about understanding your market is great, and they should definitely do that. And I think a great way to do that is with a swipe file. Because if I look at what Dan Kennedy has written to doctors about enhanced practice management, I understand all I need to know about doctors and practice management. I don't have to study a damn thing other than what Dan Kennedy has written, because it's all, not only is it reflected from Dan Kennedy's incredible brain that understands what people want and has had years of talking to doctors, it's the result of years of Dan Kennedy testing what works to doctors and what hot buttons and what they apply to. So if Dan Kennedy is hitting them on exclusivity, I know I better include exclusivity. If Dan Kennedy's hitting them on looking good in front of other people, I better hit them on looking good in front of other people.
That's so good. That's such a great piece of advice. I don't think I've ever heard, David, anybody articulate it that way. That's such a great piece of advice. I've never even thought about that myself. The value of really being able to learn about your market based on what other smart marketers have already done and are continuing to do over and over again as they market more and more to that marketplace. That's so smart. I think also, I love what you said. I love the idea of, I think new marketers, new copywriters, they often don't realize that you can and should swipe from marketing materials that are outside of your marketplace, because it's not about, look, we're not just looking at the actual words and phrases, right? We're looking at the underlying triggers, the hot buttons being pushed, and the ways that those hot buttons are being pushed. You might go into a totally different marketplace, right, knowing that your market responds to exclusivity, and you may be able to see from a variety of other markets how they're introducing and leveraging exclusivity in their copy, giving you more fodder, giving you more ideas to better use exclusivity in your own copy. And the other thing that you said, which, you know, I just think is so valuable for folks to realize is, look, I think, and I believe it was Dan Kennedy who said it at one point, that it doesn't take a genius to look at something and figure out all the reasons why you can't use it, like why it's not appropriate for you. He said the real genius is in figuring out how this can be applied to your business. And I think that's a big difference between average copywriters and A-listers, is that an A-lister like yourself, obviously, can look at any piece of copy and glean value from it, glean some insight on how to improve your own copy. And
that's a great way. Not only is that something that you should do when you're writing copy, when you're doing that, but that's a great way to train yourself in how to write copy. Is to constantly be taking something and go, okay, let me, like in music, you transpose the music to a different key. How can I transpose this to a different key and make it appropriate to how I work?
Yeah.
Publish it or not. Not even for something to publish, but just to train yourself to be able to base your copy on a different idea, on another idea.
Yeah. And I think that, yeah, that's so smart. And I think too, when looking at good swipes, proven, tested stuff within your marketplace, right, from great marketers within your marketplace, you can also see, like you had already mentioned, you can see themes that are used over and over. Like when you said, Dan Kennedy uses exclusivity, and I see that he uses it all the time, maybe in varying ways, but he uses it all the time for XYZ market. Well, if I'm going to go to that market, then I should be using and leveraging exclusivity. And I think that also is just wildly valuable when you start to realize there are some chunks that are missing from my copy or some emotional triggers that I'm not leveraging that others are. Like I was having a conversation earlier with Rich Sheffrin about swipes, and he was telling the story about many years ago about a piece of copy that somebody brought to him that was, it was well-written. It felt well-written, but it wasn't performing. And some folks need to realize that you can have a well-written piece of copy, but if it's missing certain core emotional triggers, then it may not perform nearly as well as it could. Right. And so at the end of the day, remember that chunks of copy, pieces of copy, all copy is there to serve a purpose, an outcome. Right. And that outcome is ultimately based on what we understand about the marketplace, what moves the marketplace, what they care about. Right. The emotions that move the marketplace. And so we may be missing, even from a well-written piece of copy, some core emotional drivers. And therefore, we suffer for it. And so having a good swipe file can also expose you to what are the chunks that smart marketers are using and smart copywriters are using over and over that I'm missing from mine.
And yeah, so- I felt that when I looked through the volumes of swipe, one of the things that I felt was the stuff that I don't do, right? I saw Dan Kennedy's stuff. And there's so much of it is like tacky. Yeah. It's Dan Kennedy dressed in a cowboy outfit. It's Dan Kennedy. They had one where it was like Vanity Fair to promote their seminar. And Dan Kennedy was on like a woman's sexy body. And Bill Glazer was on a woman's sexy body. And I would never let someone do that to me. And I realized there's something I could learn from that is to be I'm still not going to have someone do that, but to be a little freer, because people like fun. I'm sure you've seen that in promoting your own seminars and events, and people they want it to be enjoyable and entertaining, as well as you use the word well-written, which just sounds dull and boring in a certain way. And you can't, no matter how well-written something is, you can't be dull and boring. And when you look at a swipe file, and you see what other people have done and the ways they are not dull and boring, it inspires, like you said, muse, right? It inspires you to maybe add a little bit of that spice into your dish.
Yeah, no, said. I couldn't agree with you more that it's so interesting to look at all of those Dan Kennedy pieces over the years and to see these common trends of when it came to the live conferences, the themes that were used from the Vanity Fair to the circus to Houdini to Superhero and Kiss and all these things. And to realize that, like, it almost forces, at least it used to force me to ask myself, am I resisting something out of my own personal preference, even though it's being right. done for a reason. I know that if these things are being used over and over and over by super smart marketers, then there's a reason why. And so maybe I have to take a look at my own reasoning. The other thing, David, that I think is that it really does, in line with what it is that you just said, it really does help us to identify blind spots. Right. So sometimes the longer you've been writing copy, especially for the same marketplace, it becomes very easy to go back into the same standard, the same thing that I've done, and the same kind of chunks and the same triggers. And we start to think that's the way that should be done, even when we're getting good results. Like the saying of good is the enemy of great. Sometimes it's good. But it, right, there's something missing that we don't even realize, that we don't see until we go outside of ourselves, that could turn it from good to great. And I'm just such a huge fan, really. I'm such a huge fan of using swipes. I know that I remember it was Gene Schwartz who talked about with ideas and themes and hooks for campaigns. And he talked about it doesn't come from inside you. You don't sit down right. with a pad and a pen and all of a sudden you're coming up with these big ideas. It comes from, first of all, you need a lot of ideas. You need a lot of input. And often it comes from outside of you. It comes from exposure to other things. And then like you talked about earlier with the banana, it's really just pulling things together and seeing connections, being able to look at a good marketer's campaign, even for another marketplace, and pulling things out, seeing connections that you can use with your own marketplace. And so I think that it's so important to use a good swipe file to keep your thinking fresh, to make sure that you don't fall into these ruts and miss out on other pieces. And I think that it's just so important.
And you, over the past 10, 13 years, you've actually collected quite a bit of swipe and you're just releasing it, making like 250 copies of an actual printed version of all the swipe that you've collected over the years available.
Yeah.
Can you tell us more about that? That's there. And there it is.
Yeah. So this is going to make me sound crazy, but so I would say that it's probably been about 13 years ago or so, I realized the value of a swipe file, of a good swipe file. I knew that I wanted, if I was going to model and study and learn from anything, I wanted to make sure that I was learning from the best marketers and the best of their campaigns and copy. And so what I did was I got on as many lists as I possibly could of the top marketers, the top direct response companies. Some often I had to buy products. I wanted to see what they were sending to customers. I wanted to see what they were sending to prospects. And over the last 13 years, I collected everything mailed out by the absolute best marketers on the planet, from Dan Kennedy, Frank Kern, the Agora companies, Newsmax, Russell Brunson, did I say Jay Abraham, Neil Patel, Caleb O'Dowd, Motley Fool, you name it. I collected everything from them. And I collected their direct mail. I believe that unlike online, where, let me actually take a step back for one second. And number one, I think it's important for everybody to realize that I believe that a swipe file is not merely a collection of marketing pages and ads that are nice looking and that you like. A legitimate swipe file is a collection of proven and tested copy and advertising ideas. Proven and tested being the key. I knew that, and this is even more true today, that the majority of online campaigns that we see, no matter how nice they may be and well laid out, and no matter how they may look, the majority of campaigns online aren't winners, right? The majority are not winners. And I really relatively have very little way to confirm or prove the performance of those campaigns. I knew and know today still that it costs big money to use direct mail, to send out a campaign in the postal mail. And so what that means is that the copy is typically dialed. The ideas are typically dialed. When you're talking about from the best marketers, right? You're talking dialed promotions, dialed copy. And so I began to collect it.
What do you mean when you say dial? Do you mean test or dialed in? Like they've had an opportunity to really dial it in?
I would say a little bit of both. So sometimes, oftentimes, especially today, oftentimes before something gets dropped in the mail, it's been tested in some other way. And so they may use something. And then once it proves to be the winner, then they'll drop it in the mail, right? Pre-internet, they were testing in the mail. Now a lot of folks are testing online, and then the best of the best makes its way into direct mail, as well as even when they're not necessarily tested in direct mail, they are typically going the distance with the copy, the offers, the campaigns in direct mail, right? You could put up a campaign in an hour and a half online today and like whip it together and throw it up and with very little cost, especially if it's just being exposed to your house file. And no one's doing that in the mail because it costs big money to do that. And so I saved everything. And when I say that this collection, so number one, it is every possible direct mail format that you can imagine. So there are sales letters in here. There are postcards in here. There are lift letters in here. There are magalogs in here. There are catalogs in here, like you name it. And there are offers for everything that you can imagine. Certainly low ticket, mid-tier, high ticket. There are front-end offers. There are back-end offers in here, and there are offers for things, webinars, physical products, live events, conferences, five-day challenges, lead magnets, you name it. And so I really began to study it. And then, David, where things began to really compound for me, and this is what makes this thing so special, right? You're talking over, this is 22.4 pounds, over 4,000 pages of what I call marketing gold. One of the big value aspects to this bad boy is that I got to see trends in the most expensive campaigns from the best marketers, meaning I got to see how often Dan Kennedy, for example, is using exclusivity. How often is Dan Kennedy using fear? How often is Dan Kennedy using urgency? How often is Dan Kennedy using testimonials or in contextually? Or like, I got to see the things that were used over and over. So I got to see what things were used one time and then never again, telling me that maybe it wasn't valuable for the promotion, and what things are used over and over. So again, taking a step back, I'm looking at the best marketers, their most expensive campaigns that are almost always dialed right out the wazoo. And I'm getting to see the things that they're using over and over and over. It doesn't get much better than that. The other thing that why I also really relied on direct mail, besides the fact that it costs big money, it's dialed right from the best marketers, is that I also know that there's a huge amount of copy in here that most competitors will never see. The competitors that are only swiping from and modeling the online stuff, seeing, let's say, the back end promotions that are only being sent out via direct mail, they're not seeing the sequences that are only being used offline. And so for folks that have access to this kind of swipe file, you have a tremendous competitive advantage because you're modeling from and swiping and studying copy that isn't going to get knocked off the same way the online stuff is. The fact of the matter is that online stuff goes from new and innovative to old and dated in sometimes in a matter of weeks when the marketplace just pounces on it. You don't have that same result when you're looking at the offline stuff because the majority of competitors will never see it. And so it gives an advantage in that I'm seeing copy and I'm seeing copy chunks and I'm seeing emotional triggers and I'm seeing trends and I'm seeing hooks and angles that they're not seeing, which gives me an advantage in way of being able to come up with unique angles, unique hooks, unique offers, and that sort of thing. And yeah, this has really become my most prized marketing possession. Now, I'll give you real quick. So I originally, obviously this collection was for me. When I moved into a new house a little bit over a year ago. I said to him, I don't want to bring all these bins because I had a tremendous amount of bins. I don't want to bring all these bins. My wife is going to kill me. And so I said, let me have this thing organized and put into a physical thing. like we also talked about offline, I love physical. I'm a physical guy. I'm an analog guy. I like to have it in my hands. I like to be able to highlight stuff and annotate stuff and just flip to it and flip back and forth between things. And so I ended up having a team member, dedicated full-time team member. It took her 6 weeks, about 120 hours to take the bins. I mailed her the bins. I had to take a hand truck to the UPS place to ship this thing to her. It ended up taking her, like I said, a month and a half, 120 hours to turn this into these binders. And I realized then that I've got to share this with my highest clients, my top one mastermind members. And so we had a bunch of copies made. And in order to get this discount, like a higher level, we ended up with 31 extra copies of this thing. And so I decided I was going to go back to a certain segment of my list and give 31 people the opportunity to get this. Well, I could not believe how fast those 31 copies sold, how the value that people saw in this. And then we had a whole bunch of people afterwards that said, how do I get the swipe file? And now I'm like, we don't have any more. And so I convinced my team a few weeks ago to spend an arm and a leg to have 250 additional sets of the, what I call the decade plus swipe file. It's five manuals like this. They're each about 800 pages, 4,000 total pages. We had 250 copies, 250 sets made. I don't have any plans on offering it again after this. It's been quite the adventure spending all this time and energy having these bad boys created. And so today at noon, we gave folks the opportunity to grab one of the 250 sets. This is one of a kind. There is nothing like this on the planet. I don't believe that there will be, again, anytime in the future, anything like this. And right now is a chance for people to get one of the 250 copies. This thing is, you could literally, David, you could literally look at a new page of copy every day for the next 10 years and see something brand new every day, literally. That's how many pages.
That is a page a day. You're right.
Page a day.
You can write. And there's so much on a page. We think of a promotion as being one idea, but even a 12-page, 18-page magalog is packed with ideas of how did they do this? How did they do this? How did they portray this? Yeah. How did they sell this herb? How did they get this investment across?
Yeah. Yeah. And also, for what it's worth, over the years, I've really fallen in love with the copy approach that like an Agora uses, that you use, which is often wildly different from the typical approach that most people are taught to use, in that best copy, it feels valuable. I remember going mm-hmm. through some financial letters where I was like, this is so informative. I want to save this. So good. It's so informative. It's so well, call it researched, right? It's there's proof, there's evidence. It's a rock solid, airtight, emotional and logical argument. It's proving a point. Like, it's so valuable that I want to hold on to this. And so like the beauty of some of these pieces, like the magalogs, is it really shows you the art and science of being able to deliver not only effective marketing, but marketing that feels valuable, that doesn't mm-hmm. feel like a pure pitch, doesn't feel like you're hammering somebody by. And so it's, to me, it's a beautiful way of doing marketing where you can market over and over to your tribe, to your house file, to your email list when you use that approach, because you are giving value as you are making an offer. And so you're not leaving somebody feeling like you just tried to pound them into buying. And so I love it. And so there's just so much value to be extracted from something like this. I really believe I hate selling. I'm not a good salesman. I don't like to sell. That's not my thing. Fortunately, I'm decent at marketing. But for the serious student of direct response, of copy, this is really, should really be a no-brainer. Because the quality of the copy, the promotions, the hooks, the leads, the arguments, the offers in here are second to none. And if you were willing to go through even a fraction of this decade plus swipe file, the improvement to your copy skills, to your persuasive skills, to your argumentation, your offer construction, your attention getting, your differentiation will be light years ahead of where it's at right now. And I believe, before I forget, I just want to do this. I believe that for folks that are your fans and that are interested in this, they can go to toddbrown.me/David. And so go to toddbrown.me/David. That's going to certainly let me know that you're part of David's tribe so that we can roll out the red carpet for you. And of course, give David credit. You'll be able to go and grab one of these. If you're interested, I recommend that you do it fairly quickly, if not now, or when we're done, when you're done listening to David and I, because there are only 250 sets. That's it. On the page that you'll go to, you can see I show a copy of the invoice. That's not some made up false fake scarcity thing. That's legit 250 copies. And once they're gone, that's all she wrote for this bad boy.
Yeah. Aren't there also, I don't want you to forget that there are bonuses as well. There's, you had me and Sheffrin and a whole bunch of people, like, so to really break down what we do to create these things, which is great, I think.
Yeah. So I'm going to, so let me see if I could do this. I wasn't planning on doing this, but let me see if I can do this real quick. I'm going to bring, let me see. I'm going to share my screen and show you something. So there is, I wanted to do something super cool. And so we'll do this and then I'm going to share my screen in a second. So I wanted to do something super cool and something that I've never seen done before. And so I went to 8 top marketers, copywriters, folks like yourself, David, and I asked for them to do special, unique kind of in-depth dissection of a piece of their copy, high ROI, productive piece of copy. And so what we've put together is this gigantic bundle, these eight additional swipe video walkthroughs from some of the sharpest marketers and copywriters out there. So the first one is from a mutual buddy of ours. I believe that these are all mutual friends of ours, is the structure, the secret structure behind upsells that sell with a 40%+ conversion rate from Justin Goff, who is arguably the king, the recognized authority when it comes to increasing your average order value. I don't believe there is anybody better than Justin when it comes to moving the needle, making you more money on every sale. And his go-to strategy is the structure that he teaches and breaks down in this video for the upsell, producing at a 40%+ conversion rate. Then there is from our friend John Benson, who is the inventor of the video sales letter. That's no joke. That's not exaggeration. He is the creator of the video sales letter. John shares the stealth words and phrases that turn average VSLs into 7-figure mega hits. John's methodology has produced more winning VSLs than anybody else on the planet. And he's got a unique approach to certain words and phrases that he uses at certain points in his VSL. He breaks that down for you. The hidden chunks that can give any marketing message immediate credibility. This is a walkthrough, David, your walkthrough of a killer magalog, one of my favorite formats to study and learn from. There is from another longtime direct response marketer and a great copywriter in his own right, Doberman Dan Gallipu, the unconventional copy structure proven to outperform any other approach when selling subscriptions. From Rob Marsh and Kira Hug, the simple email copy patterns that always work to have readers see you with celebrity charisma. From our good buddy over at Copy Chief, the founder of the largest community, or certainly one of the largest communities of copywriters. He's got the You Game email sequence that brings in sales for any new product without needing proof or testimonials. There's Matt Basak, arguably one of the most successful email copywriters on the planet. This dude has been around, I believe, longer than I have in the online marketing world and has produced tens of millions of dollars, if not more, from pure email-only campaigns. He is also a testing fanatic, so his subject lines are tested out the wazoo. He gives a full breakdown of his tested and verified email subject lines getting the highest open rates right now. If you do any kind of email copy, email marketing, this alone can be worth its weight in gold for you. And then from my dear friend, Rich Sheffrin, the guru to the gurus, the guy who has trained more top online marketers, direct response marketers than possibly anybody else in the game today. He shares the secret webinar structure and timeline, which continues to pull in seven figures in sales whenever it's modeled. This is an unbelievable breakdown of a webinar using Rich's unique structure. And he breaks it down in terms of chunk, what comes first, second, third, how he's doing it, why he's doing it. And so this entire free, this entire bonus bundle is free for all 250 folks who grab the Decade Plus swipe file. And so there you go. Cool. And so, like I said, you guys can go to, if you want to grab one of these, or you want to get more details on this, go to toddbrown.me/David. You'll have all the information you need. You'll be able to see everything that you get, a full breakdown of the bonus bundle that I just shared with you. And you'll be able to grab one of these bad boys before they're all gone. I don't know how fast these are gonna sell out. It could be today, it could be tomorrow, it could be the next day, it could be in an hour. I have no idea. And so if you think you want one, I highly encourage you to go and at least get the details. You can go to toddbrown.me/David.
Yeah. Thank you, Todd. I love swipe files. I love having a hard copy of something. I feel like that's so different from having it on I've got so much stuff on a computer, like buried samples of things buried in files somewhere. But when I've got it right by my side where I can pull it out and just flip through it, be inspired by it, or just look for something specific in it, it really makes such a difference.
Yeah, I love it. I love seeing it by your desk. And it's a total honor, man, for me to know that you've got that by your desk. Like, I love it. And I love knowing that it's just going to benefit, you know, so many other people. Because like I said, this thing has really just become my prized possession. I know what this has done for me. I know how it's changed my perspective on copy and marketing, my ability to come up with ideas and promotions and arguments, ability to write better copy. I'll end with this. I really believe, even with everything that we've talked about today, David, I really believe that if folks do nothing else other than passively read through this swipe file, that alone can radically improve your copy chops, your ability to craft persuasive copy, your ability to trigger emotions, your ability to ultimately drive the sale without coming off salesy in your face, just from passively reading this. And so if nothing else, this is some of the best copy education that you will ever get anywhere. And I mean that.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I would add, you'll get a lot of benefit if you read through it and look through it. But if you really study it, if you use it, if you see how these amazing pieces are done, it'll just have such an influence.
Yeah. Yeah.
On your writing, on your marketing, on every aspect of it.
Yeah. Said. I don't want to take up any more of your time. I so appreciate you chatting with me. As always, I love to spend time with you. I love learning from you. I love studying what it is that you do and say, and how you do it and how you say it. And like I said, total honor for me to have you spend some time with me, total honor for me to see the Decade Plus swipe file by your desk, and an honor, of course, to have you share this with your people. And so thank you so much, man.
Thank you. I've learned from this as well. And I always enjoy talking with you, Todd.
All right. Thank you, David.